All right, everyone. Hello again. My name is Antonio Freitas, and on behalf of the Brazelton Touchpoint Center and Sesame Street Workshop, I'd like to welcome you to today's conversation, Caring for Each Other. How to use Sesame Street Community Resources for Health Emergencies with Families. Before we begin our conversation today, just a few housekeeping tips. The first is that for any technical difficulties, you're going to want to reach out to Kayla Savelli, whose email was just put on this prior to the PowerPoint deck being presented. For any questions that come up through today's 1 hour conversation, please feel free to use the chat window that it sounds like a lot of people are telling us hello from. So thanks to all of you that have begun the conversation. We have more than 4,000 people registered for today's conversation. And so we're excited to hear from all of you and share our resources with those meaningful relationships you're building. Finally, today's conversation will be a webinar that's recorded and posted on the Brazelton YouTube channel tomorrow. It is currently being placed live on Facebook, so there's a number of different places that you can watch and engage in today's conversation. But let's begin. Again, as a member of the Sesame Workshop, my name is Antonio Freitas, and I'm delighted to welcome you all to an important conversation today with our panelists to talk through how to stay calm and in control with Sesame Street resources. As a result of COVID-19, families around the world need to adjust, adapt, and keep each other safe. In response, the Sesame Workshop is launching a Caring for Each Other initiative, a long-term commitment to supporting families for the duration of this crisis. While grownups are trying to understand what is happening and how to respond, we want to be sure to speak directly to children as they find their own ways of understanding the changes in their everyday lives and all the big feelings that come with those changes. Over the course of this next hour, we'll connect with experts from a wide array of fields connected to early childhood and hear how Sesame Street has utilized our free online platform for parents and providers called Sesame Street and Communities to create resources that address health emergencies to respond to children in times of need. We'll explore the key concepts that led to the development of these resources and spend some time sharing out what they are and how they may be helpful to you. At the end and throughout this conversation, we'll make sure to keep lines of communication open via the Zoom chat window and panel expert information to get your answers answered in questions in English and in Spanish. All of the resources we'll be talking about today can be accessed online for free via the website www.ssic.org. The information can be accessed on any and all digital devices, including phones, tablets, and computers. And during today's conversations, we'll also be providing links in the chat window to each and offer the different resources we'll be talking through and quick and easy ways to accomplish similar end goals of child's comfort and connection if Wi-Fi in your area is harder to get. Let's start by introducing our panel. As mentioned before, my name is Antonio Freitas, and I work as a senior content manager at the Sesame Workshop to build out trainings on the ways that parents and providers can use our resources. I'm going to pass the microphone over to Dr. Joshua Sparrow, the executive director of the Brazelton Touchpoint Center, to introduce today's panelists and facilitate our discussion.
Thank you so much, Antonio. Thank you, Sesame Workshop. And thank you for joining us today from all over the world. We really are all in this together. In these difficult times, it is more important than ever to keep our babies and children in mind and to find comfort for ourselves in all the ways we know we continue to nurture, protect, and enjoy them. The Brazelton Touchpoint Center is delighted to collaborate with our wonderful friends at the Sesame Workshop to help share these resources with parents, family-facing professionals, and communities everywhere. And I want you to know that Antonio has superpowers, as I think you'll soon find out. I also want to thank our panelists who are joining us today to share with us what they are seeing and hearing about families' experiences right now and how they think the Sesame resources can help. Before introducing them, I wanted to apologize for not having simultaneous Spanish translation for today, and that's because of the speed at which we've had to put this together to respond in the ways that we can to this crisis we're all facing. But we do plan on having simultaneous Spanish translation for the Brazelton Touchpoint Sesame Workshop webcasts coming up on May 6th and June 10th. And now let me introduce our three panelists. We have Marcela Clark, joining us from Houston. She's the director of the United Way of Greater Houston Bright Beginnings Program, which is an innovative early education program designed to help children from underserved families achieve social, emotional, physical, and cognitive milestones and enter school ready to succeed. Bright Beginnings has been a very contributive member and good friend of the Brazelton Touchpoint Center Learning Network since 2005. And joining us today is also Adrián Pedroza, who is National Director of Strategic Partnership for Abriendo Puertas, or Opening Doors in English, which is an evidence-based two-generation parenting program that honors and supports parents as leaders of their families and their child's first and most influential teacher. This wonderful organization, Abriendo Puertas, has been a friend and partner of the Brazelton Touchpoint Center for many years, and I'd like to give a particular shout out to my friend, Sandra Gutierrez, the founder and leader of Abriendo Puertas, for everything she's done for families from Latin America for so many years and all she's doing in this crisis. Mil gracias, Sandra. And finally, Rocio Galarza, who is Assistant Vice President at Sesame Workshop, another wonderful partner. As an expert in early childhood educational development and the needs of young children, Rocio works with advisors to ensure that the content of Sesame Street's outreach initiatives is age appropriate, appealing, as you'll see, and effective in motivating families to use their everyday routines as learning moments for young children. Remember to send us your questions for our panelists in the chat box. The world that we live in is changing. As you all know, over the last few months, precautions to prevent the spread of the COVID-19 virus have shut down childcare and early education centers and schools, compromised the health of communities, changed the way we live our everyday lives, and led to a major shift in how people connect and stay healthy. While we strive to give our children as much structure and stability as we possibly can, we still need to do what is in our power to take care of ourselves too, so that we can simply just be there for our children. As you, our panelists, reflect on how life has changed in recent weeks, I'd like to ask you all two questions. What are some of the primary challenges that are most important to address with children, parents, and families in this health emergency? And what are some of your own responses to these challenges? Let's start with you, Adrián. You're on mute, Adrián.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity on behalf of Abriendo Puertas, Opening Doors. Daily, we are hearing directly from families out across different states that they are feeling the stress and pressures of this COVID-19 outbreak. All of a sudden, life as they know it has shifted, not just for themselves, but also for their children. As we have seen workplaces close, schools close, families are feeling economic pressures like they've never felt before, as well as educational pressures. All of a sudden, families are having to homeschool and be maybe that primary teacher for their children at home. We understand that with the various workplace arrangements that people might have to arrange for themselves at home, they're having to balance life with work at home and the education of their children. It's very important during these times that we honor parents as their child's first teacher and understand that these are unprecedented times and we cannot always expect for parents to not feel those same stresses that their children are feeling. And so what we are doing at Abriendo Puertas is, as we always do, is listen and honor parents as a primary teacher of their children at home and advocate for their children. We are continuing to provide online resources, partner with wonderful partners like at Sesame Workshop in Brazelton to amplify the voice of the resources that are available to parents and to reassure parents that these are difficult times and that we are there to support them socially, emotionally, and with all the struggles that they're facing. En estos tiempos sabemos que familias están enfrentando cosas muy difíciles para ellos y para sus niños. Y sabemos que en esos tiempos es bien importante que sigamos apoyando a familias. Abriendo Puertas sigue proporcionando recursos para familias en línea y también trabajando muy cerca con nuestros socios en Sesame Workshop y en Brazelton Touchpoints para seguir apoyando a familias durante esos tiempos difíciles. Sabemos que en estos tiempos nunca hemos visto estas situaciones y tenemos que nosotros como familias y como socios y organizaciones entender que familias necesitan el apoyo en este tiempo. Muchas gracias. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Adrián. Back to you, Antonio.
Thank you. In response to this challenge and to so many others that children and families face across the United States, Sesame launched an initiative several years ago so that parents and providers had resources to share with little ones dealing with big changes. Let's take a quick look at a video that tells you a little bit more about Sesame Street and communities.
So, what about that one?
Oh, Mama thinks that that cloud looks like an elephant wearing a cowboy hat.
Oh, yeah, I can see it. You always see the greatest pictures in the clouds, Elmo.
Well, sitting here and looking at the clouds is one of Elmo's favorite things to do with his dad.
Oh, mine too. I love when we spend special time together.
Yeah. Boy, Daddy is so important to Elmo.
Oh, thank you, son. And all you adults are so important to your kids, too. What you do matters.
Yeah. Oh, and not just the big things. Sometimes it's the small things that matter a lot, too.
Yeah, that's right. A caring adult can make a big difference in a child's life. And you are that caring adult. You are important.
Oh, look, Daddy. Look at that cloud. Does Daddy see what Elmo sees?
I sure do, son.
Yeah.
So as Elmo and his father, Louie, pointed out, parents and providers are the most important factor in supporting resilient children. Now, always, and for every challenge and trauma. And this is the reason that we created the free online platform for parents and providers with over 30 different topics to address growing children's needs in English and Spanish called Sesame Street and Communities. The changes that this pandemic has commanded to the way that we live, work, and connect has been quick and beyond what we had even thought possible. This abrupt shift can feel traumatic to adults and to children alike. We know that nearly half of American children under age 18, that's 35 million kids, have been through at least one adverse childhood experience, with more than one third of those children under the age of 5. But we also know that simple strategies can make a difference in mitigating the effects of some of these traumatic experiences. We're learning at Sesame the more that we can help families, kids, and parents take small steps, the more we can increase their chances of successful outcomes in school and life. Again, it's about helping parents build their own resilience as they help their children heal. Sesame Workshop has over 50 years of creating content to support kids and families, and over that time, we've built a high level of trust, and our furry, friendly Muppets can help deliver essential messaging in non-threatening ways. Think of Sesame like a friendly third party when it comes to approaching difficult topics, helping parents and kids, or providers and parents have difficult conversations. Sesame characters can help you bridge gaps and encourage dialogue. Our mission is to help build smarter, stronger, kinder communities, one child at a time. We here at the Sesame Street and Communities team are excited to share with you today a just released topic page of resources to use with children, parents, and providers like you on ways to stay engaged in fun and developmentally appropriate ways during a health emergency. Each of our pages introduces a topic that we've addressed in a variety of interactive ways that ensures every moment between a child and adult can be made meaningful. All of our different topics have a wide variety of resources, including those that are bulleted on the slide. Printable resources are those documents that are easy to print out and have a small green icon of paper at the bottom of each resource. Coloring pages, directories, card games to cut out, and even stories to share are just a few of those types of resources. Interactive games are those activities where children can use devices like phones, computers, and tablets to explore settings and circumstances as their furry friends, to practice and to role play the best ways to handle settings like preschool or a doctor's office or a garden patch that they might see in their own near future. A small blue icon of a hand will let you know about these types of resources. Videos on our health emergencies page can show friends of Sesame Street, young and old, the different ways that we can stay healthy, informed, and in control when life feels a little bit overwhelming, and can be easily found by looking for a small orange icon with the play button. Storybooks are interactive texts that children and adults can share in a few different ways. Children can turn the pages of a digital book while an adult reads it to them, or just simply press play to have the story read aloud from the screen. Articles, highlighted by a small purple icon of a newspaper, are informative texts, usually at a third grade reading level and with easy to access bulleted information. We found these to be most successful between parents and caregivers and providers. Articles, like all of our resources, have a single sentence summary on top called a big idea that let people know what the resources are all about. And finally, workshops are a bundled package of resources that the team at Sesame and Communities has put together. These workshops may include a combination of two or three different resources from this list that we found work really well together. You can feel free to use them in whatever way works the best for you. In recent weeks, the teams at Sesame have bonded together to balance a variety of perspectives and needs with expert health recommendations that led to a new topic page on Sesame Street and Communities called Health Emergencies. The topic page, just launched on Monday, is intended for parents and providers to use as they work to address children's social, emotional, academic, and health needs in health emergencies. All the different types of assets we'll be talking about today we've created to address the three key concepts reflected on the topic. They are prevention, routines, and emotional support. Let's watch a quick introductory video from the Health Emergencies topic page to learn a little bit more about what this looks like.
Wash, washy, wash, washy, wash, wash your hands. Scrub them while you sing this song. Wash, washy, wash, washy, wash, wash. Rub your hands and fingers and the places in between. Using soap and water, make sure that's so clean. Wash your hands. Great job, you're almost done. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Taking care of yourself is also taking care of others. We are all in this together.
So I can tell you that Washy Wash song is an earworm. You can hear it once or twice and it will not escape you for a while. In this Washy Wash video, Elmo models the first concept of prevention with the correct way to wash his hands. We also know that coughing and sneezing into your upper sleeve or elbow is another way to stay healthy and can still practice everyday health habits indoors, like comforting strategies that include healthy nutrition and moving our bodies. To get more insight into other ways to stay healthy at home, let's connect with Dr. Sparrow and our panelists.
Let's start with Adrián again. Maybe you can tell us a little bit what some of the ways that families can stay healthy at home are, because I know that Abriendo Puertas is working hard to getting out desperately needed information about these basics to protect children and family members from infection spread.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Sparrow. Abriendo Puertas, Opening Doors, will be releasing a series of videos to provide information to families about how to protect themselves at home. We are, of course, reinforcing what the CDC recommendations are, as Elmo said, to wash our hands, to stay at home, only leave for essential reasons, to make sure we're social, we're remaining 6 feet from folks if we have to leave the house, and more importantly, that we are there socially and emotionally for families, that we encourage that families still play, have fun at home, try to create routines, things like what we will hear today on the video that will be supported and promoted by Brazelton Touchpoints and Sesame Workshops. Queremos que las familias, ¿verdad?, que sigan las recomendaciones de CDC, que laven sus manos, ¿verdad?, bien, que no toquen su cara, que traten de quedarse en casa si no tienen que salir de sus casas, y que nos mantengamos 6 pies de cada uno si tenemos que salir. Vamos a sacar unos videos en español que va a ayudar y que va a dar esta información a familias. Y es bien importante que sigamos, ¿verdad?, lo normal, tratemos de jugar en la casa, de salir afuera cuando es posible, para mantener una rutina con nuestros hijos y nuestras familias saludables.
Thank you, Adrián. And Rocio, anything you'd like to add? Because you know a lot about what Sesame Street brings to help with this issue. You're on mute.
Yes, no, I'm muting. There you go. So the washing your hands definitely is one of the most important steps that we can teach our kids. It's also one that needs the most repetition. So it's not only important for us to expose children once or twice to the idea of washing hands. It's important for us to teach them how by modeling and by being there and reminding them what it is that we need to be doing and when. So that's why not only do we teach them to wash their hands, but also that after you cough or sneeze or after you're playing, after you go outside, all of these are times where you have to wash your hands as well. The other thing that we talk about in terms of prevention is actually trying to keep some of the healthy habits that we've always promoted, right? Children still need to brush their teeth every day. Children still need to try to eat some of these healthy foods that we always say are so important to them. I know availability and accessibility to some of these healthy foods are an issue. But one thing that we can control is how much exercise or how much movement. I don't say exercise because it's movement really that we can do indoors. And that's something that we can still do with kids. The other thing is, in terms of prevention, is that the body and the mind are very much connected. And in order for us to keep these healthy habits, we need to think about also how are we comforting children. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that later. But it's important for us to include them as part of those healthy routines that we know are important for young kids.
Thank you, Rocio. Back to Antonio.
En español. Sí, de prevención, siempre decimos que lavarnos las manos es increíblemente importante porque nos ayuda a lidiar con los gérmenes, pero para los niños pequeños no es nada más decírselo una sola vez, es decírselo varias veces, modelar, hacer ejemplo, ¿no?, de cómo y cuándo se lava uno las manos. Como adultos nos tenemos que lavar nosotros nuestras manos y hacer que nuestros niños vean cuando lo estamos haciendo y a lo mejor también ayudarlos mientras lo hacen. Tenemos que recordarle que tienen que hacerlo después de estornudar o de toser y que también deben hacerlo después de jugar, después de ir al baño, antes de comer. Todos estos son momentos en que hay que recordar a los niños porque no se van a acordar ellos solitos. No siempre se acuerdan solos. También estamos tratando de que la gente practique hábitos saludables que lo haríamos en todo momento. No todo está cambiando. Es importante mantener nuestros hábitos saludables, como lavarnos los dientes. Eso tiene, siempre lo tenemos que hacer por la mañana y por la noche. Y tenemos que motivar a los niños a que lo hagan. También tenemos que tratar de comer comida nutritiva y no sabemos que hay problemas de acceso y que eso puede ser un poquito difícil, pero podemos intentar. Otra cosa que tenemos un poquito más de control, aunque sea dentro de la casa, es movernos y movernos con nuestros niños. Ellos necesitan movimiento y nosotros podemos usar nuestro ejemplo. El baile es lo más fácil. A nosotros nos encanta bailar. También tenemos que tener estrategias de ayudar a reconfortar a los niños, porque el cuerpo y la mente están conectados. No es uno versus la otra, estamos todos conectados. Y de eso vamos a hablar un poquito más luego para darle a los niños un sentido de control y de seguridad.
Thank you, Horacio. Back to you, Antonio.
Great. Thanks, panelists. And thanks to all of you that are listening and engaged in the chat window, as well as the team from the Brazelton Touchpoint Center that are passing links to some of these resources. In addition to that video, we've also included several printable resources like It's Time to Wash Your Hands, Washing Because We Care, Sneeze and Cough Safely with Grover, along with corresponding videos that include some other titles. These resources are great to use, easy to memorize, and quick to sing. If Wi-Fi access or printing capabilities are limited, consider writing down the lyrics to sing the song and place your new page up in the bathroom or close to some soap and a sink. Reflected across all of our resources is the idea of collective learning for both children and the adults in the family. We want to empower parents along with their children to become learners. You are learning from your child and they are learning from you. Our second key concept, routines, centers around the idea of learning that can happen at home with simple activities. Like many of you, families around the world are adjusting to a new reality where parents are being asked to simultaneously parent and teach. At Sesame, we believe that there is a more strategic focus that could be on creating meaningful moments between family members where learning occurs naturally. Routines then become the best way for children to stay engaged. And I believe, Dr. Sparrow, you were gonna talk with Rocio a little bit about the importance of those routines.
Yes, let's go back to Rocio so you can tell us more. You began to touch on that. And this time I will be sure to leave time for you to tell us in Spanish and English. Maybe you can start in Spanish.
Oh, empiezo en español, claro que sí. Bueno, okay. Para nosotros es muy importante, claro, la rutina. Si nosotros como proveedores sabemos que las rutinas es lo que ayuda a los niños a sentir tener un sentido de control, aun cuando las cosas, pues estamos en crisis y hay muchas cosas que cambian. No todo cambia. En términos de nuestras rutinas, como habíamos hablado, las rutinas de salud, por ejemplo, el lavarnos los dientes, eso se tiene que hacer todo el tiempo. También hay otras rutinas que podemos apuntar como rutinas que siempre vamos a hacer. Por ejemplo, el leer un libro antes de acostarnos a dormir. Y si lo hacemos consistentemente, se lo podemos hasta decir a los niños, mira, esto no ha cambiado, siempre leemos este cuento antes de acostarnos a dormir. Otra cosa que queríamos hablar un poquito de las rutinas es que ayuda a escribirlas, pero tengo que admitir personalmente, mi primer itinerario de mis rutinas con mis niños fue bien ambicioso y no funcionó. Las rutinas, como todo en ser papás, en ser y también proveedores, toma tiempo y toma persistencia. Ahora el schedule de rutinas que yo tengo con mis niños es bien diferente, es mucho más simple, pero con todo y eso de intentar una y otra vez, tomó tiempo. Así que hay que dejarles saber a los papás y a los niños que, mira, esto va a tomar un poquito de tiempo, podemos ser consistentes, a veces funcionan, a veces no, y juntos estamos bregando con la situación y tratando de que nuestras rutinas sean más consistentes. Estamos aprendiendo uno de los otros. Y por último, me gustaría dejarles saber, porque lo experimenté esta semana. Yo vivo en la ciudad de Nueva York y vivo cerca de un hospital. Y desgraciadamente escucho sirenas todo el tiempo porque lo que está pasando en el hospital es muy, muy difícil. Y aunque después de 3 semanas tengo unas rutinas con mis niños, fue un momento el lunes en que las rutinas personalmente y mentalmente no me ayudaban a mí. Los niños seguían sus rutinas y le ayudaban a ellos, pero yo me di cuenta de que dentro de mis rutinas y de las rutinas de la familia no había un momento donde yo la había puesto como un momento para lidiar con mi estrés, un momento para respirar. Si meditan, un momento para meditar, pero puede ser algo hasta tan simple como respirar o tomar agua y tomarse un tiempo, unos minutos. Así que es importante que, aunque sea bien difícil a veces pensar en uno mismo, el momento del papá o de la mamá de tomarse ese break, esa respiración, hay que incluirlo como parte de nuestra rutina diaria y no puede ser siempre al final del día. Puede ser a mitad del día porque el estrés puede darte durante el día también. Así que es importante que incluirlo como parte de las rutinas que le ofrecemos a los papás. So now I'm going to translate. So I was sharing that, yes, routines are incredibly important. They're incredibly important for children because they give them something to expect even when things are in chaos. And so in order for us to keep routines, it's very important to the same way that in parenting, most of the things that, and most of the routines that we had before have been a trial and error and a lot of persistence. This time around is going to be, it was going to take some persistence and some trial and error. But there are some routines that are not going to change, like we were saying in terms of healthy habits, like brushing teeth. And some routines that we can choose for them not to change, like reading a favorite book at the end of the day. And highlighting those and making sure that children know that those are things that haven't changed is important so that they know that there is some consistency in their lives. But the persistence is important. I shared a personal experience that my schedule and my routines, I actually wrote them down the first day, and it was incredibly complicated and I failed miserably. So the routines and the schedules might change and might shift as you trial different things and you learn from one another and learn from your children of what is best for the family based that you're handling so many different things, work, teaching them at home, all of these different things. So they might change and there might be a period of trial and error. And seeing the very first schedule and the schedule that you might have in 3 weeks, it might be different, and that's okay. The last thing that I shared was I learned, and you know, my routines now with the kids are working much better. But this week even, I learned that there was a flaw in my routines. I live near a hospital, and of course, there's a lot of sirens, and it's pretty tough some days. And in my routine, I didn't put any time, even 5 minutes or even 1 minute, for me to just sit down and breathe and take a little bit of water or just take a moment for myself. And I realized that is an important part of the routine, making sure that parents have that too. Encourage them. It doesn't have to be a long time, but encourage them to take moments throughout the day where they can take a breath and are able to have a moment where they focus on their feelings as well.
Thank you so much, Rocio. Starting back in 1996, one of the guiding principles of the Touchpoints approach was and has always been that parenting is a process of trial and error. And now parents are taking on more than ever. And one of the most important points we wanted to be sure to share with the thousands of people who have tuned in today from all over the world is that parents and other family caregivers are being asked to do so much more than they ever have. And we want to be sure that parents understand, although they always have been and always will be their first, most important, and most influential teachers, that does not mean that it is realistic or reasonable for them to hold themselves responsible to be their classroom teachers, that is just too much pressure, and that in order for parents to be able to also take care of themselves, that's something that we're just going to have to let go of and wait until the coast is clear to be able to get going again with. Thank you so much, Rocio. Now back to you, Antonio.
Great. Thank you all for sharing your expertise and your insights on all of this. We're going to continue with that second key concept of routines, but talking about them in the context of some of our resources, which are workshop bundles. We know that children love to play anytime, anywhere, and with almost anything. And as they do so, they're exploring the world around them and practicing important skills crucial to brain development. But grown-ups benefit from play too. Laughter and silliness can help reduce stress and strengthen bonds between us. Disrupted routines and lots of change make playtime even more important for everyone in the family. Playing together keeps everyone's morale up, creating precious memories in an otherwise stressful time. Explore the playful learning ideas in the varied learning at home bundles we've organized. And while you can select any learning at home bundle in any order, we found the sequence that's reflected on the PowerPoint deck slide you see here, the most fun way for children and adults to begin to learn together. In the learning at home for now bundle, highlighted in bold black and also reflected on the pink side of the right page, we've included a combination of assets that you'd find, including an article for parents on work-life balance, two printable resources where a child can create a family schedule to adjust to the new normal that Rocio was talking about and celebrate a new family tradition. And there's also an interactive game. Laughing and joking around brings families together and helps them express their affection too. gather together and play this game show, this game style show game, Monster Fairy Family Challenge, anytime or anywhere. It's a silly 30-second challenge to learn, share, and bond together with everyone at home. And families can work together to collaboratively draw, sing, solve riddles, dance, giggle, and best of all, just enjoy each other's company. And again, if Wi-Fi or a printer isn't easily accessible, consider using a simple blank piece of paper to make a grid for the routines so that children can create their own updated mornings or new family traditions and share proudly on a wall or fridge. Our third and final concept, emotional support, focuses on the ways that parents, caregivers, and providers can maintain community for children in calming, consistent ways. While many of the challenges we have face aspects we can't control, there is a way to share information, maintain health, and recognize things that we all know that we can manage. And to this end, we've used articles and videos at Sesame Street Communities or www.ssic.org to explain this point. So within the health emergencies topic page, we've included several adult-facing articles that address the ways you can continue to provide emotional support to the children and peers around you. These articles, including self-care, talking with kids about COVID-19, comfort strategies, and managing uncertainty, all include icons at the top that allow you to star and place in your own personalized SSIC library for easier access later on, upload on your own personal devices, or print out hard copies of for others. All articles include the big ideas across that big purple banner on the top and filtered information that remind the reader of the title, the broader concept that it can be found under, the specific age of the child that it's about, and typically how long it takes to read. Before helping others, we know it's important to address our own needs, wants, fears, and hopes. And this article, Self-Care, highlights some of the ways to be your best self so that you can work to get little ones out to that same place of resilience. For providers on this chat, we found the most successful part to be when a link of these articles can be sent easily via text to a parent with a short personalized line. Something like read this and thought of you is a great way to begin to use these in conversations with others. And along with our health emergencies page, we also have many other topics with helpful resources to share with little ones who have big feelings. Related to Sesame Workshop's Caring for Each Other initiatives, we've also included an article on Abby and the importance of self-soothing hugs during tough times. Let's take a look.
Everybody, it's me, Abby. My mommy set up this really neat little video chat place so I can visit with everybody. And I wanted to talk to you because, well, I know a lot of us are having some big feelings right now. I know I am. And that's okay because, well, we're all in this together. And I've been spending a lot of time with my mommy and my stepdaddy, Freddie, and my brother, Rudy, and, well, she taught me something really nice. I think you're gonna like it too. She said that when I have big feelings or little feelings or anything in between, I can just give myself a hug. That's this, a self-hug, just like that. And it's really nice. I hold myself real tight and I take a deep breath and I feel comforted. And well, if you're having those feelings too, you give yourself a nice big hug and know that all of us here on Sesame Street are thinking of you and we're hugging you nice and tight. All right, well, you take care. I love you and twinkle out.
Caring for each other. Visit sesamestreet.org/caring for videos, activities, and tips for the whole family.
So a sweet note related to that is that all of our Muppeteers actually had their own Muppets sent to their private residences so that they could make and continue to make videos that were going on the Sesame Workshop social media platforms and continue to connect with children, families, and adults all across the world, even in this time. We also found that it's important to talk about and share videos about self-soothing techniques like giving yourself a hug because it involves and invites children to try and figure out ways that they can self-regulate and control things that are within their realm of control. The Sesame Street and Community's topic page we've discussed today is a part of a larger Sesame Street initiative called Caring for Each Other. And online, you can find a wealth of free resources that parents and providers like you can use with children in your care during times of need. We'll make sure to share the link for Caring for Each Other here, along with other great resources at the end of this webcast, and again, in conversations and resources on the Brazelton YouTube channel in the following days. Shifting gears now for Dr. Sparrow, having conversations one more time with some of our panelists. Dr. Sparrow, I think you might be on mute. Thanks.
Sorry. So now that we've had a chance to look at just some of the resources that Sesame Workshop has to offer, and people really love that, by the way. Everybody said, awesome, so cute. I'm doing that tonight in the chat. I'm going to turn to Marcela Clark to think with us about this question. How do you know a child is receiving the emotional support they need?
Hello, everyone. Marcela Clark from Houston. First of all, thank you, Sesame Street, for this opportunity and for reaching out and giving us the gift of all the materials that you're providing at no cost and in the language that many people in this world speak, and they don't have access to those resources otherwise. Thank you to the Brazelton Touchpoint Center, always at the lead of what's necessary to bring voice to the voiceless. With that said, I would like to tell you that, first of all, I think that we need to acknowledge that the fact that we don't know exactly what are the consequences of the corona pandemic. What we do know is that there are preventive steps that we can choose to take to avoid contamination. And at the same time, we can also choose to be kind to each other and collaborate to create safe places for children and their families. As terrible as this pandemic is, I invite you to look at it as an opportunity for all of us to learn to live with each other in a more respectful way. And in that process, we will be modeling to children what adults should do. And that is take care of them, but involving them at the same time in the process. So as it said in this program, we must take care of each other. So how do we know that a child is receiving the emotional support they need? The good news is for those children who are in group care, is that you are in good hands. If you're attending a family childcare center or a childcare center, these providers have a tremendous amount of expertise in dealing and working and facilitating difficult human situations, such as a child first day away from their parents. Providers know how to soothe a child in distress. Right now, I know many providers who are going way beyond their traditional role, such as extending their hours of service, providing meals to take home for parents, and even doing children's laundry for exhausted first responders. Also, thinking about family engagement coordinators and providers that are purchasing diapers and formula to provide for the families that they don't have access, that they cannot leave their homes, that they need those necessities, and yet we have a family engagement coach doing all this kind of work to connect with the families. So how do we know that we are actually meeting the needs of a child that is in distress? So from the early childhood education point of view, I will tell you that we must observe and we must listen for clues and wait, pause. Pause for an invitation to enter into the child's universe, because young children are highly competent and perceptive. And if we allow them the space, they will let us know what they need. As we attempt to understand the child's message, we need to take into consideration each child's temperament, so we don't overwhelm a child that is slow to warm up, or ignore the child that is flexible and falls to the crack because it doesn't demand attention. Or tone down the environment for the most energetic child. And within all of this, hopefully, primary caregiving is taking place. Why? Because children need to be clear about who is the adult available for them. Setting up the environment for listening means that there is something for everyone to engage in. And within that environment, there is a soft place to land for all. In this environment, you can provide invitations and outlets for children to express themselves in many ways. And please don't make assumptions. Wait, pause, take time, evaluate. Right now, the situation calls for an environment with a structure, yet with open-ended activities and materials. This is a great time to take children outdoors and engage with nature. If there is a safe place for them to study what is happening, it is outdoors right now. Spring is here. And that is something that is easy at no cost, given that it's a place that is safe. I am going to switch to Spanish now. So, bienvenidas, amigas de todo el mundo. Un placer que hayan todas podido llegar a este lugar. Muchas gracias a Sesame Street por ofrecernos esta ayuda y al centro de Brazelton por lo que hace por todas nosotras que lo sabemos muy bien. Es importante reconocer que realmente no sabemos cuáles serán todas las consecuencias de la pandemia, pero sí sabemos que existen pasos preventivos que debemos utilizar para evitar la contaminación y al mismo tiempo podemos elegir el cuidarnos los unos a los otros y colaborar para crear espacios seguros y saludables para los niños y su familia. Aún con, lo terrible que es una pandemia, igual nos presenta una gran oportunidad para todos nosotros de aprender a vivir juntos en forma más respetuosa, con más tolerancia y que los adultos deben hacer, y modelándolo para los niños lo que los adultos deben hacer, cuidarlos e involucrarlos al mismo tiempo, tratarlos con respeto y como dice el programa de Sesame Street, take care of each other, que nos cuidemos los unos a los otros. So, ¿cómo sabemos si un niño está recibiendo el aporte, la ayuda que se necesita, que él necesita emocionalmente en este momento? La buena noticia es que la mayoría de las personas que trabajan en early childhood o en la educación infantil tienen mucha experiencia, muchísima experiencia ayudando a las familias a trabajar en situaciones humanas difíciles, como lo es el primer día que un niño se separa de sus padres, ese primer día cuando entran al jardín infantil. Sé que en este momento muchas de ustedes están yendo mucho más allá de lo que se espera dentro de su rol de proveedora. Han extendido sus horas, preparan comidas para los padres para que los lleven a casa, e incluso he escuchado que alguna de ustedes le lavan la ropa a los niños para que los padres, que son los que están respondiendo a los hospitales y la policía, que esos padres puedan tener más tiempo con los niños en las casas. So, lo que mi equipo me recordaba es que debemos observar a los niños y escuchar para que ellos nos den pistas y que debemos escuchar, esperar y pausar para que ellos nos den una invitación a entrar al universo de cada niño. Porque cada niño es altamente competente y perceptivo. Y si los dejamos que ellos nos permitan en su espacio, vamos a poder llenar sus necesidades mucho mejor. Así como intentamos entender al niño y sus mensajes, también tenemos que tener en consideración que cada niño tiene un temperamento difícil y diferente. No queremos que un niño que es más tímido, no queremos asaltarlo con mucha información y con preguntas. Tampoco queremos ignorar a un niño que es flexible y que porque no demanda atención, no le damos atención. O tampoco queremos que un niño que es altamente energético tenga que tenga, tenemos que adaptar el medio ambiente para que ellos se puedan ajustar internamente. También hemos conversado mucho dentro de nuestros grupos y colegas que preparando el medio ambiente para un niño, para que lo podamos escuchar, eso significa que hay muchas cosas que podemos hacer para que el niño pueda encontrar algo en el cual ellos se puedan conectar y también obtener un lugar donde puedan caer a la suavidad. También las invitamos a que crean invitaciones y formas para que los niños se puedan expresar y en muchas formas que ellos se puedan expresar, sea artísticamente o sea activamente. La situación en este momento pide que tengan un medio ambiente que tiene estructura, pero también que tiene mucha flexibilidad, que invita a tener actividades y materiales abiertos. Este es un gran momento para llevar a los niños a la naturaleza, para salir al jardín y estudiar con ellos lo que está pasando en este momento, que es la primavera. Muchas gracias por escuchar.
Thank you so much, Marcela. We, as you can imagine, with thousands of people tuning in from all over the world, are just inundated not only with questions, but with really wonderful suggestions. You are all already answering each other's questions and really helping each other out. So I just want to say that we will finish at the top of the hour and we will hang out with you for another 10 or 15 minutes. We won't begin to be able to answer all of your questions then, but we'll pick up on we can for that period of time. I did want to start though by celebrating all of you and your heroism and that of all the helpers in this crisis. One of the comments said, "My school is amazing. They are inventorying certain supplies like diapers, wipes, baby food, and getting ready to distribute out to families in need. Very proud to work for Educare 2 Hawthorne in Tulsa, Oklahoma." And there are so many other programs that are doing things like this and other wonderful things. And I'm sure that all these programs are being really careful to wear gloves and to use no-touch delivery. Another question that was asked was, "What strategies for self-care can we start using now?" And then one of you answered, "Self-care for tonight, take a long bath, take a walk in the neighborhood at dusk, give self hugs in front of the mirror and smile." So you, everybody is really in this together, helping each other out. We'll come back to questions after we formally end at the top of the hour. I did just want to also add that one of the most important things that we can all do is to be sure that we comply with our city or state's requirements to shelter in place as strictly as possible. That is one of the most important things that we can do. And many of you have commented on that as well. So back to you, Antonio.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Sparrow, and thank you, panelists, for all of those great pieces of information. And just to start to close out today's conversation, you know, we've talked a lot about the great wealth of resources in both English and Spanish that are free for parents, providers, and all members of a family reflected on Sesame Street and Communities. That's www.ssic.org. But the three big concepts that really helped us build up all of the resources we talked through today were prevention, routines, and emotional support. And so again, prevention, just that big idea that there are easy ways to stay healthy by washing hands, coughing correctly, and eating fresh fruits and vegetables each and every day. The second key concept, routines, really sort of hammering home that point that routines are meaningful ways that everyone in a family can learn from each other. And then finally, with regard to emotional support, in an effort to build assets like this, we need to make sure to remember that for children to be resilient, adults need to be observant, responsive, and patient, addressing individual needs in individual ways with individual children. And as we move to the next slide, we know that you're getting a lot of information from a variety of sources about how to best use your time and energies. And while we're so thankful that you're a part of today's call, we also want you to know that this is one more resource that you can use in a way that is, again, most meaningful to you. There is no prescription. It is customized to meet your needs just the way that you want it to fit. We do, however, have some suggestions on what you can do to make this the most meaningful way it can be in our conversations that we've learned with other people. The first is to explore the site. Just by clicking onto www.ssic.org, you can dive a little bit deeper into the health emergencies topic page that we've addressed today, and also see the wide array of other topics we've addressed with those same style of resources at the ready. The second thing that you can do is to make an online profile. When you make a profile, you create a library of resources customized to meet your needs. As you explore pages and find those meaningful resources, you can simply star them and put them in your own personal library for later use, so that when you go back to the website, you don't have to spend too much time surfing on other pages or topics, but you can go right back to your library and get just what you need. And finally, thinking about those stakeholders closest to you in your circle of care, we encourage you to find one of the resources that we talked through today that fits your need. Think about children, parents, and other providers you may reference these resources with, and the best ways they like to learn. While one child may understand a lesson through an interactive storybook, another may use the washy wash song we heard at the beginning to remember the right way to wash their hands. You know these resources and the best way to communicate them to people in your circle of care. As we start to wrap up, you should feel free to stay connected with your friends at Sesame across multiple social media platforms, including Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, and Pinterest, with all of our information loaded there directly on the page. And before I pass it over to Dr. Sparrow, on behalf of the Sesame Workshop team and everyone that got to build this conversation, we wanted to thank all of the panelists, all of the participants, and everyone that is doing the work to help lift communities and keep everyone safe. We want to thank you for joining today's conversation and look forward to future opportunities in upcoming webcasts to learn from all of our panelists and all of you in the coming weeks. Thanks for all that you do on behalf of children, parents, and other providers every day in different ways. Dr. Sparrow?
Thank you so much, Antonio. I told you, Antonio has superpowers. We look forward to being with you again, Antonio, and with all of you for our upcoming webcasts with Sesame Workshop on Wednesday, May 6th, and Wednesday, June 10th, same time, same station. We'll be looking carefully at all of your questions and comments, the hundreds of them in the chat, to help us get ready to be responsive to you for these next episodes. Although we know and we hope that the situation will be better then than it is now. In the meantime, you'll be receiving an email from us tomorrow with links to the Brazelton Touchpoints website, its Facebook page, and its YouTube channel, where you can download the recording of today's webcast to watch it again and share with your friends, colleagues, and families. And we do plan to have our upcoming webcasts with simultaneous Spanish translation. You can find the list of Sesame Workshop resources presented today, along with many others, and information about upcoming Brazelton Touchpoints webcast series, including the April 15th episode of Learning to Listen, about individuals finding their voices through music, theater, and animation on the Brazelton Touchpoints Center website. Thank you all for all you do. Stay healthy and strong. And now for those of you who can stay on for another 10 or 15 minutes, we will attempt to try to address some of your many questions. There literally are hundreds of them, and we won't be able to get to all of them, but we will study them as we prepare to join you again in May. So I thought I would start with a comment that I'd ask you to respond to, Marcela, and another comment that I thought connected to it. So one of you commented, I'm the trauma response coordinator for 25 school districts in my region. I've been advocating with superintendents and principals for the primacy of social emotional needs over educational needs. We know that when people are feeling stressed and afraid, they can't learn or teach. How can we emphasize social connection, especially to school administrators, so that students, teachers, and families can focus on what will promote resiliency? And then before you respond to that, Marcela, I wanted to read you a point that was made that I think comes together to begin to answer this, because as I said, everybody who tuned in has been helping each other out with their questions and concerns. So here's the other point that I think is related. One of the most important things to share with parents is that learning does happen all through the day. So include them in household activities and join them during play.
So even in times when we're not in emergencies or crisis like we are right now, in general, the voice of people in other systems than early care and education have this belief that learning takes place in academic settings. That is not so with early childhood, and right now is not so with any of us. And any of the children who are living this pandemic by staying at home and by being taken care of by parents who are trying to work at the same time. So my response is we need to continue to advocate. Number one, parents know what they're doing. They know their children. That is not our place. Our place is to scaffold the child and the parent together and to advocate for them and to really send a clear message. Their learning is taking place all the time. In our settings in early care and education, what we do is we document what is happening with the child throughout the day. We do something that is called documentation. We take pictures and then we share that with parents. And then we connect to the areas of development. So clearly we're able to show parents and give them peace that their children, yes, they are learning. But before we can learn, we have to have peace of mind. If we're not tranquil, if we don't have a place where we can rest, children will not be able to learn anything. And I think that that includes the adult. The adult needs to be centered and ready to participate with the child.
Entonces, en español? Por favor. ¿Por qué no?
¿Por qué no? Entonces, amigas, escucharon lo que dije. Lo importante es llevar el mensaje a todas partes, que la educación no solamente tiene lugar en sistemas académicos, pero en todas partes, cada momento que un niño vive es un momento de educación. Y lo importante es tener la habilidad de documentar lo que el niño está haciendo para poder compartirlo y perfeccionarlo con la información que los padres nos proveen y luego compartir. That was a summarized version.
Thank you, Marcela. Now I'm going to turn to you, Adrián. I'm hoping that one of the questions was about reaching out to families with resources. So maybe you can tell us more about what Abriendo Puertas is doing to reach out to families with resources to support them with activities to do at home with their children and resources for them to take care of their basic needs. And then maybe you can tell us what we all can do.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Sparrow. So it's very important during these times that our families really reach out to those trusted partners that they've always depended on, right, during more normal times. So, you know, our schools, nonprofit organizations, you know, places like Sesame Workshop and Brazelton Touchpoints, you know, during these difficult times, those trusted resources and organizations hopefully are continuing to amplify their resources that they have available. At Abriendo Puertas Opening Doors, we are posting mini sessions that we typically work with our implementing partners across the U.S. to work directly with families through workshops where they gather groups of parents and create a safe space for parents to learn together using popular education approaches and where they can discuss the hopes and dreams and aspirations for their children, as well as all the challenges that come with parenting. So we're providing a space virtually on Facebook Live. If folks go to our Abriendo Puertas National Facebook page, you will see Facebook Live sessions every Tuesday and Thursday at 10 a.m. Pacific time. And so this is just a way for us to hopefully get the message out directly to parents that, you know, we can still create virtually as much as possible these spaces where parents can convene, can build social capital, can lean on each other. We all know that for many of us, right, our own family members, our friends, and maybe our grandparents and our aunts and uncles, that's who we go to during difficult times. And so we need to, during these times of social distancing, continue to reach out to them by phone, by Zoom, and create these safe spaces for families. And so as much as we can, at Abriendo Puertas, Opening Doors, we're doing that for people virtually as much as we can do during these times. En estos tiempos, Abriendo Puertas, Opening Doors, regularmente damos sesiones con nuestros socios por todos los Estados Unidos, directamente a padres en grupos, pero en estos tiempos estamos en Facebook Live cada martes y jueves dando mini sesiones de 20 a 30 minutos para padres, para familias, para recibir información sobre cómo pueden, qué pueden hacer ellos, ¿verdad? Como familias, como padres, para seguir apoyando a sus hijos, ¿verdad? En áreas de educación, en áreas de emocionales, de salud. Y estas mini sesiones se están haciendo cada semana y es un modo que nosotros podemos seguir, ¿verdad? Apoyando a familias, honrándolos como los primeros maestros de sus hijos. Y sabemos que en estos tiempos difíciles tenemos que al mismo tiempo, ¿verdad? De seguir hablándole a nuestros tíos, a nuestras abuelitas, abuelitos, para hablar con ellos y recibir ese apoyo, ¿verdad? Que necesitamos como familias para seguir asegurando que nuestros hijos, ¿verdad? Estén en un ambiente saludable y también que nosotros como padres estemos en un ambiente saludable.
Thank you so much, Adrián. I just wanted to say that Sandra Gutierrez told us how fabulous you are, and of course she was right. Thank you. I'm now going to turn to you, Rocio, with this really wonderful, important question. Listen to this. I am a medical clown, not able to visit my 5 hospitals. I'm concerned about the children who are in hospitals and seeing fewer visitors during this. How much do you think, and I should say, our Brazelton Touchpoint Center is based at Boston Children's Hospital. And so we know that many hospitals around the country are working hard to get children home who can be cared for at home so that they will have less exposure to the virus in hospitals. But here's the question. I'm concerned about the children who are in hospitals nonetheless, and that they'll be seeing fewer visitors during this period. You know, some hospitals are really restricting who can come in, again, to protect patients and healthcare providers. So how much do you think videos from their clowns, like Sesame videos, will help, and what other ideas might help them?
Well, I think if there are any moments that we can provide for kids where they can just be kids, they can laugh, they can have moments where they can lighten up their load, because we know there's so much going on. Any opportunity that we can give them is helpful. So if it is in a form of a video from our Muppets, that's great. If it is in a form of a Facebook Live with a clown, you should try, because part of what happens when we are in these crises is that because we're not giving children outlets to just be kids, sometimes they're bottling up these feelings and they will come out at random times through tantrums or through behaviors that are regressive behaviors. And so I think that any opportunity that we can give them and any outlet like social media, like videos that are being posted, like perhaps sometimes if it's possible, little text messages that are sent that the parents can read to the kids or adults can read to the kids, all of those are important. We, in addition to what we are doing, what we've been seeing is a lot of museums, a lot of other, a very famous book writer that used to be a Sesame writer has one doodling session, famous doodling session at 1 o'clock every day. We are seeing a lot of wonderful, creative people that are offering children those outlets, and they have been very, very popular because, again, children need a chance to be kids and to have playful moments that could bring up, that could give them some emotional breathing room to everything that's going on. So yes, use social media, posting your videos, making sure that those hospitals that you used to go to know that these postings are happening, because families have this, we know that, and a lot of adults have this, they can show those videos and those postings to kids wherever they are. Those are very useful ways.
Y entonces, en español, por favor, Rocio.
Yes, lo que acababa de comentar es que los niños, sobre todo en estos momentos de crisis, donde hay tanto, donde necesitan tanto apoyo emocional y donde también sienten la energía de muchas personas que estamos preocupadas y que también pasamos por nuestros altos y bajos, necesitan momentos en donde ellos son simplemente niños, donde pueden reír, donde pueden tener el sentido de humor, donde pueden jugar. Y hemos visto que sea videos de Sesame Street, como nosotros lo estamos haciendo, y estamos haciendo muchos videos donde son rutinas y chistes y mucho en el sentido del humor con nuestros Muppets. O sean otras personas como museos, artistas, hay muchos escritores. Hay uno en particular que a la 1 de la tarde tiene su doodling, una sesión de dibujos. Todas estas son oportunidades que ayudan a los niños a tener ese momento de soy niño ahora, ¿no? Puedo reír, puedo tener el sentido de mi infancia, ¿no? Una vez más. Así que sí motivo al payaso y a otros a que hagan sus propios videos y a que dejen saber a las personas donde han hecho voluntariado que esos videos existen y porque aunque no puedan estar personalmente, sí sabemos que los adultos tienen esto. Y si tienen un link, pueden ver el video, pueden ver la sesión de Facebook Live o de algún otro medio social. Así que sí, motivo a todas las personas que tienen la oportunidad y que conocen ya, que tienen acceso a algunos de estos lugares donde los niños necesitan un poquito de ayuda, que hagan sus propios videos y que también dejen saber a la comunidad que existen.
Thank you, Rocio. And I just want to add that if you think back to how you felt when you watched the lovely little video we just saw of Abby giving herself a self-hug. I mean, I was watching the faces of our panelists and everybody just softened and smiled. So just to say that Sesame Workshop has half a century worth of experience understanding what children feel, how they think, how they understand language and nonverbal behavior. And the Muppets really know how to get right there with children and speak to what they're feeling and connect with them. So I do feel hopeful that these videos really will reach and touch children. And I just can't thank you enough, friends at Sesame Workshop, for making these videos and for sharing them with all of us and with the world. So I have two final questions that I'm going to put together that any can feel free to respond to. The first is, how can we explain to the children what's going, why they can't interact with their friends? And the second, which I think is related, is what tips can you give to parents whose stress is spilling over to their children? Who would like to start us off with these final questions before we sign off?
I'll go ahead and start off. Thank you for that question. Very important question. And again, just want to echo what you said about Sesame Street, really all, you know, being a trusted resource and trusted messenger to our families. And we're very grateful that you all continue to do so during these challenging times. You know, at Abriendo Puertas, Opening Doors, we are recommending and actually releasing a PSA video in Spanish with captions in multiple languages here next week about how to talk to our kids about during these challenging times. And one of the things, you know, some of the points that we make are to keep, to be honest with our kids, right? To, of course, be honest and to share with them in an age-appropriate way what is happening, and to use simple terms to reassure them that they are going to be okay, that that the parents or their caregivers will be there with them during these challenging times, and to make sure that they remain open to questions, and their caregivers remain open to questions, to check in with them regularly, that, you know, don't assume that because maybe they're not sharing some of the anxiety and stress they're feeling, that they're not feeling it. It's always important to check in with them and ask them, how are you feeling today? And to be there to answer any questions. And of course, it's very important to limit the viewing of media and the news to our children during these times, especially the younger children, because there's so much being put out on media that it's not that we're trying to hide real information from them, but you know, as we all know, news and television is many times the target audience are adults, and so it's important that we not always sort of leave those news stations on for our children to watch. And if we do, that we debrief with them and talk to them about what they saw if they happen to see a news station. En español. En Abriendo Puertas, Opening Doors, primeramente queremos dar las gracias a Sesame Street Workshop porque siempre han sido una organización y una plataforma bien importante para nuestras familias, para información confiable, ¿verdad? Que nos da buenos recursos para nosotros, las familias y nuestros hijos. En estos tiempos, Abriendo Puertas está creando un mensaje público para familias que vamos a sacar la semana que entra en español, pero va a tener también en escrito en otros idiomas esta, la información de cómo hablar con nuestros hijos durante estos tiempos bien difíciles. Y el mensaje que les damos a las familias es que seamos honestos con nuestros hijos, ¿verdad? Sobre lo que está pasando, ¿verdad? De no mentirles, obviamente, usando idioma, ¿verdad? Y información a su nivel, ¿verdad? Si son niños pequeños, ¿verdad? De hablar en forma simple con ellos sobre lo que está pasando, de ser honestos. De también de tratar de no enseñarles las noticias, ¿verdad? Y de que vean mucho de lo que vemos como adultos, porque esa información, ¿verdad? Es especial para adultos. Entonces, si ven esa información en la tele, que
I think we may have lost Adrián. We will come back to Adrián for the rest of the Spanish version of his answer. And I'm wondering if Marcela or Rocio, you would like to take over on how we can explain to children what's going on and how parents can deal with the stress that's maybe spilling over to children.
Sure. Earlier, I said that not only children need to be held and scaffolded during this time, but as well as parents. Because parents, as we had said many times, they're going through tremendous amount of stressors right now. I totally agree with Adrián that we must be truthful and transparent with children without giving all the gore details that this pandemic entails. I believe that we need to provide outlets for children to express what they're feeling. We need to provide time for them to process all the information that is out there. And when I said we need to provide outlets for them, you know, we have young children. If we're talking about a 2-year-old, a 3-year-old, you know, they're acquiring language and they don't have the ability to express the way that a 10-year-old could, I think that it will be important to offer them opportunities to do art activities, to read together, to create stories about how they're feeling, to do dramatic play, if it's possible. I know all these things are happening in childcare centers right now, but those are things that we can share with parents. You know, the concept that I talked about earlier, to truly observe and listen to what's going on in the child's world so we can have access to that universe. So I'm going to go to Spanish now. So lo que estoy diciendo es que deberíamos, primero que nada, siempre ser transparentes con los niños y decirles lo que está sucediendo, pero evitar de darles todos los detalles que no corresponde que un niño pequeño tenga que ver o escuchar. Y lo que yo sugiero es que tengan conversaciones con los padres, como muchas de ustedes lo están haciendo, y que hablen de las muchas lenguas que existen para que un niño se pueda comunicar. Y por ejemplo, yo mencioné que podían hacer actividades de arte, también actividades de drama, y proveer un tiempo para que los niños puedan procesar y poder expresar los sentimientos que ellos tienen. Okay.
Thank you, Marcela. Adrián, it looks like we have you back. I'm not sure if you know when we lost you, but there may have been a couple of final points that you were making in Spanish, if you can pick up.
Sí, bien breve. Solamente quería decir que es importante, ¿verdad?, que cuando hablemos con nuestros niños, ¿verdad?, que les preguntemos, ¿verdad?, cada día cómo están, ¿verdad?, porque muchas veces no expresan, ¿verdad?, pero en preguntarles, sí les damos la invitación de hablar con nosotros sobre lo que está pasando. Y tratar de crear rutinas en nuestra casa, ¿verdad?, de darles una vida lo más normal que les podemos en la casa en estos tiempos muy difíciles, es bien importante, como hemos escuchado en este taller. Gracias.
Thank you, Adrián. And lastly, to end our conversation for now until we come back together again, Rocio, if you had thoughts you wanted to add to how we can explain what's going on to children and tips for parents whose stress may be spilling over to children.
Yes, I actually wanted to start with the last comment from Adrián. The conversation starts with a question, right? It always starts with the question of what is it, where are children now? And sometimes that question can lead to a verbal answer. Sometimes that question leads to some observation, like Marcela was saying. Once that conversation gets started, we do have some touch points in very simple ways of explaining COVID-19 in our website. And they're not meant to be used exactly the same way. Each child, the conversation is going to look slightly different, but it gives you an idea of when we say being honest, but not overwhelm, or perhaps not give too much information. It gives you an idea of how much information might be appropriate for this age. And I suggest that you take a look at those and make them your own, right? It is a conversation that depends on each family and also where children are. I also wanted to mention that it is hard to this concept of being away from friends or not being able to be close to people, because particularly at this age, that's what you're searching for, that's what you want. So it's important for us to for kids to explain that sometimes, and this is an opportunity, no, for them to know that sometimes we show care by being close, by hugging, by showing a touch affection, right? And sometimes we show that we care first and foremost by caring for each other and caring for the self, right? By washing hands, by making sure that we are okay. And that's important right now. And this is one of those moments where when we take care of ourselves, we are helping others and we are caring for others. It's an important concept. And there's not many opportunities for us to bring this up. And this is one learning moment for that big lesson that we are all learning together. And finally, when it comes to parents, first of all, let's give ourselves a break. We're all doing the best that we can. And yes, sometimes you're going to feel a little overwhelmed and emotional. And I think that we need to realize too that the learning moment here is not that we need to be stoic and strong all the time, is that strength also has those moments where emotion can be hard. And so it's how we handle those emotions. If I'm crying, how am I explaining that to my kid? That's what is going to help the child cope with those emotions and give them a way of doing it themselves as they grow older, as they develop, right? So yes, we can cry sometimes. But how do I explain why I'm crying with my kid? What do I do after I cry? How do I calm myself down? That is also modeling. And so we have to make sure that we're setting ourselves expectations that we want also our kids to have, and that is that to feel, we can feel, right, in such circumstances. Now in Spanish, I first wanted, primero quería dejarles saber que, bueno, como decía Adrián, empieza la conversación con una pregunta, ¿no? Tenemos que saber qué es lo que saben los niños y cuánto saben. Y los niños te pueden dejar saber con, como decía Marcela, contestar la pregunta con sus comportamientos, tanto como sus palabras. O sea, que es una conversación bien individual. Pero podemos empezar viendo algunos de los tips que tenemos de cómo explicar a los niños. Y pueden verlo en el website. Tenemos una básicamente como un libreto, ¿no? El libreto no es para que lo usen exactamente como está, pero para darles una idea del tipo de información, de cuánta información se puede compartir con los niños que es apropiada. También queríamos dejarles saber que no tenemos muchos momentos en que podemos enseñar a los niños que hay veces que para cuidar a los demás tenemos que cuidarnos a nosotros mismos. Y este es uno de esos momentos. Sí, los niños normalmente quieren el abrazo, quieren estar cerca de otros niños, de sus abuelos, de muchas otras personas que ahora no pueden. Pero este es un momento en que podemos enseñarles, bueno, si queremos ayudar, queremos demostrar que queremos a los demás y que nos importan, tenemos que cuidarnos nosotros mismos. Además de esto, en términos de los papás, queríamos también dejarles saber a los papás que, bueno, tenemos sentimientos, no podemos dejar de sentir. En este momento son tantos estresores. No es el llorar, no es el sentir todos estos sentimientos, es cómo los manejamos para modelar, para darle ejemplo a los niños de cómo lo pueden hacer ellos también. Si lloro, ¿cómo me calmo? ¿Cómo lo explico? Ay, es que estoy bien triste, me siento muy, muy triste. Respiro profundo. ¿Qué hago próximo para calmarme? Los niños están viendo cómo nosotros mismos buscamos esa manera de regularnos, ¿no? Y no es malo, es bueno que ellos vean que nosotros estamos expresándonos porque también estamos modelando cómo manejarlo. Así que vamos a usarlo como momento de aprendizaje, tanto para nosotros, pero también para modelar momentos apropiados, ¿no? De cómo manejar estos sentimientos.
Thank you so much, Rocio. What a powerful note to end on. Thank you, everybody who joined us, and for all of the help that you have given to each other and to us. Thank you, Rocio and Antonio and all of our friends at Sesame Workshop for today and for the wonderful resources that you've given to all of us. Thank you, Adrián Pedroza and Sandra Gutierrez and everybody at Abriendo Puertas for all of the support that you're providing to families around the country, and to Marcela Clark in Houston at United Way Bright Beginnings, and to our team at the Brazelton Touchpoint Center, Autumn Strasbaugh, Kayla Savelli, and Ashley Gaddis, and everyone else who's made it possible to bring this webcast to you. Please come back again on May 6th and June 10th. In the meantime, if you'd like a diversion from the COVID-19 story, please tune in to our Learning to Listen series on April 15th, where you hear about young people finding their voice through the arts young people with autism spectrum disorders in theater and in animation studios. In the meantime, look for your email tomorrow and log on to the Brazelton Touchpoints website or the Sesame Workshop website to find these Sesame resources. And you can watch this recording and share it with your friends by downloading it on the Brazelton Touchpoints Facebook page or YouTube channel. Thank you very much. Stay healthy and stay strong.